Maura Murray, born May 4, 1982, disappeared on the evening of February 9, 2004, after a car crash on Route 112 in Woodsville, New Hampshire, a village in Haverhill. Her whereabouts remain unknown. She was a nursing student completing her junior year at the University of Massachusetts Amherst at the time of her disappearance. On the afternoon of Monday, February 9, before she left the university campus, she emailed her professors and work supervisor, writing that she was taking a week off due to a family emergency. This claim could not be corroborated by her family. At 7:27 p.m., a local woman reported a car accident on a sharp corner of Route 112 adjacent to her home. A passing motorist who also lived nearby stopped at the scene and asked the woman driving the car if she needed assistance. She declined, claiming to have called roadside assistance. Upon arriving home several minutes later, the motorist reported the accident to emergency services. At 7:46 p.m., law enforcement arrived at the scene, but the woman had disappeared. Police traced the vehicle to Murray, and initially her case was treated as a missing persons case, as investigators believed that she may have wanted to disappear voluntarily. This speculation was based on her travel preparations, about which she had confided nothing to friends or family, and no obvious evidence of foul play. In 2009, Murray's case was given to the New Hampshire Cold Case Division, and authorities are handling it as a suspicious missing persons case. In the years after Murray's disappearance, her case would receive media attention on 2020 and disappeared, and also garner significant speculation on internet message boards and forums, with theories ranging from abduction to voluntary disappearance. In 2017, the case was the subject of a documentary series on the Oxygen Network, which described Murray's disappearance as the first crime mystery of the social media age, having occurred days after the launch of Facebook. The update: cadaver dogs have hit in a basement of a house near the accident scene. The house was rumored to have connections to Maura's disappearance at the time it occurred, but the owners would not allow access. The house has been sold. The new owners allowed access to the basement. Police don't seem to be interested in the new information and claim they searched the house previously with cadaver dogs and they did not hit. Maura's father believes she is buried there. Fred Murray believes he's hit a major break in the 15-year-old cold case of his missing daughter, Maura. On February 9, 2004, 21-year-old Maura Murray withdrew $280 from her bank account, drove north, crashed her car, and was never seen again. She never told anyone where she was headed or why, not her friends, not her boyfriend, and not her family. Prior to leaving the UMass Amherst campus, the nursing student emailed her teachers, telling them she'd be missing a week of classes because of a fictitious family emergency. Hours later, when she crashed her car in Woodsville, New Hampshire, a passerby offered help. Maura waved them off, but they called police anyway. When the police showed up to the crash scene, Maura's car was there, but the young woman was gone. "I want to bring my daughter home and give her a proper burial," Fred Murray told WBZ. He is now 76 years old, and has dedicated the last 15 years of his life to finding his missing daughter. That's why he believes a new discovery in December 2018 could lead to solving his daughter's case. Separate from the police investigation, the devastated father has searched for his girl with the help of private investigators, experts, and local people in Woodsville, New Hampshire. On November 25, and then again on December 1, two different trained cadaver dogs responded to possible human remains in a basement just a stone's throw from where Maura crashed her car in 2004. Fred Murray had received a tip about the basement after the crash. Neighbors told him they believed someone buried a body there right around the time Maura went missing. The owners, however, never answered the door to let Fred inside. He tried multiple times over the course of 14 years. When new owners bought the house, he tried again, and they obliged. On three separate occasions, two cadaver dogs and ground-penetrating radar equipment all pinged the exact location Fred had been tipped about. He isn't sharing the location of the home publicly because of a deal he made with the homeowners, but calls its proximity to the 2004 crash site astonishing. He feels this is the biggest break since Maura went missing. Because it's right there, and I feel I can reach out and grab it, he said. In the past, everything was kind of iffy. Investigators, however, do not appear to be on the same page as Murray. New Hampshire Associate Attorney General Jeffrey Strilzin told WBZ News Maura Murray's case is still open and active, writing, "We do receive tips and information periodically, as well as generate new information from investigative efforts." Regarding the basement discovery, Strilzin said the area was searched by law enforcement in the past, including with dogs, and nothing of significance was discovered. He said investigators are considering next steps regarding the discovery by Fred Murray. But Murray isn't convinced the work is being done. "I don't believe it," he said. "If you searched before, you missed it. If you brought your cadaver dog in, something is wrong with your cadaver dog." He hopes speaking publicly about his discovery near the 15th anniversary of his daughter's disappearance will inspire investigators to reconsider revisiting the basement. He knows there's a chance Maura's body isn't in that basement, but says he wants investigators to dig up whoever is there. "There's a human body, a dead person. The odds are I think that it's my daughter." Here are the main points you should know about her case. 1. She was a student. In 2004, Maura Murray was a 22-year-old nursing student at UMass Amherst. She transferred there after doing several semesters at West Point, where she studied chemical engineering. She lived on campus and had a job with campus security. She was in regular contact with her parents and three siblings and had a boyfriend at the time. 2. She got into some trouble right before her disappearance. Several months before her disappearance, Murray had admitted to using a stolen credit card. The charges were dismissed after 3 months of good behavior. On February 5th, a co-worker reported that she became very upset after a phone call with her sister Kathleen, later revealing that she was concerned about Kathleen's addiction issues. In the days before she vanished, she was in an accident while driving her father's car home from a party. It's unknown if she was drinking that night. She and her father made plans to follow up with accident reports and insurance claims after he returned to the family home in Connecticut. 3. She lied about having a death in her family. On February 9, Murray searched MapQuest for directions to New Hampshire and made calls about renting a condo there, though she ultimately did not do so. She also made a call to a hotel in Stowe, Vermont. She contacted her boyfriend via email saying she would call him later. Then she told professors and her campus job that there had been a death in her family and she would be leaving school for a short time. Her family later revealed that there had not been any deaths. 4. All her belongings were in boxes. Later, when police searched Murray's room, they found that someone had packed up her belongings and left them behind in boxes. They speculate that she would have had time to do that herself, but it's not certain that she's the one who did. Missing from her room were her textbooks, toiletries, birth control pills, and some clothing. Presumably, she had taken those with her. At about 3:40 p.m. on February 9th, She stopped at a liquor store and purchased about $40 worth of alcoholic beverages and took $280 from an ATM. 5. She got into a car accident soon after she left. Sometime after 7 p.m. on February 9, a woman in Woodsville, New Hampshire heard a loud thump and saw a car in a snowbank outside her home. She reported the accident to 911 at 7:27 p.m., and there was some confusion about who she saw near the car. The records report that she saw a man smoking a cigarette in the car, but she later said she had simply seen a person and a red light that may have been from a cell phone. Another neighbor passed the accident site and spoke to Murray. Murray, who was uninjured but cold, asked the person not to call the police and said she had already called 888-6. Then, she vanished. By 7:46 p.m., police had arrived on the scene of the accident but Murray was no longer there. The police noted empty beer bottles in the car and what appeared to be red wine spilled on the ground around the car. Some of Murray's personal items were still in the car, but her debit cards, credit cards, and cell phone were missing. None of them were used after the time of the accident. A witness later claimed to have seen a young person who might have been Murray on foot several miles from the crash site. Well, what do you guys think? Comment below and let me know. That is all for now. I hope you all enjoyed. Thank you for listening and please subscribe. Till next time.